All right. Thank you, Kevin. Got a few. Got a few announcements this morning in your bulletins. Be sure you get a bulletin. Take your bulletin with you. There's going to be a senior adult rally in Selma Baptist Church on Tuesday, this coming Tuesday, the 28th. If anybody's interested in going, there's a sign-up sheet out there, but there's a conflict in that there's an opportunity to stand up for religious freedom in North Carolina. It's in Raleigh, and some of us are going to Raleigh to meet with the lieutenant governor and then to have a day at the Halifax Mall and go see some legislators about the Freedom of Restoration, Religious Freedom of Restoration Act. And so if you'd like to go to that, let me know about that. But if you really want to go to the senior adult thing, let me know. So I'll make sure we've got a way to get there. A new study tonight, the Family Project. Andy's going to be doing that. Encourage you to go to that. They're going to the Mudcats on Friday, May the 1st. And so a lot of stuff going on. Or is it Thursday? Anyway. Friday, May the 1st. Encourage you to stay tuned and to be a part of it and to take your bulletin with you and to be aware of what's going on, all right? And pray for revival this week. Pray that revival will begin in our country. Let's have a word of prayer together. Father God, we come before you. Thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for everyone gathered here. Lord, we all come as a part of your sovereign plan. Lord, we don't even know, Father, how infinite your wisdom is. We cannot comprehend you or fully understand you. But, Lord, that's the way it should be because we don't need to know everything. Lord, forgive us when we think that we do know everything. We pray, Lord, that your people, people in this church, your people in this community who love you, who are called by your name, who've been saved by your grace and mercy, Lord, that we will humble ourselves. And pray like we've never prayed before, that we would seek your face. Lord God, we would read our Bibles and we would be in the Word and we would stop and listen to you. Lord, we would discipline ourselves to put the priorities in the right place so that we can spend more time with you. And Lord, we pray that we would turn from our wicked ways, that we would repent. And Lord, seek your face like we never have before. You tell us if we do that, Lord, you will hear our prayer. And Lord, you will forgive our sins and you will heal our land. And Lord, our land needs a healing. Lord, we can't do it. I think the politicians can't do it. Lord, only you can do it. And it's going to come, Lord, when people turn to you and seek you with all our heart. I pray today, Lord, that that experience will be here in this house as we worship, that we will turn today and turn to you and seek your face. And Lord, we'll begin to have revival in our midst. Lord, not just a feel-good feeling, but Lord, a revival that transforms our hearts and our minds, and we begin to be in Christ, and we have the mind of Christ. And Lord, we walk with you and we talk with you each and every day. Father God, I just pray now that you would take this service and you would glorify your name. Your will be done. Your kingdom be manifest. And Father, just deliver us from the evil one and Lord, fill us with your joy. May your love be in us. Now sanctify us by your word, which is truth. Glorify your name. Glorify your name. May the name of Jesus be highly exalted. It's in Christ's name we pray. All God's people said, amen. Amen. All right. How many of y'all believe in heaven? Amen. Y'all need some more. Believe God has a place prepared for those who love him. Amen. Amen. All right. How many of you believe better is one day in his house than thousands of days elsewhere? Amen. Well, you get a chance now to sing about it. So please stand with me. You know, one day with God is better than 1,000 days without him. And we can experience and hear him here on this earth. The Bible says where two or more are gathered in his name, he's dwelling amongst us. He's in our midst. And so, you know, he's in our house today. So let's praise him, let's worship him, and thank him. Hallelujah. Please stand up if you're able.
How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day.
Awesome, God.
Psalms Thank 84 you. Says, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. I tell you, no vacation home will compare to what it will be like to be in the house of the Lord. In my Father's house, there are many, many rooms. In my Father's house, there are many, many rooms, and I'm going up there now to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may also be.
If I go prepare.
One day, before we know it, our lives here on earth will come to an end. And, this would be very bad news if it wasn't for the fact that Jesus came. And whenever he came, he died for our sins and he brought us hope that we don't have to worry about death anymore. We're going to live forever with our Father.
You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet. to me. You heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven. You are so good to me. You heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You ride upon the clouds. You lead me to the truth. You are the spirit inside me. You ride upon the clouds. You lead me to the truth. You are the spirit inside me. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. I will sing again. You are my strong melody. You are my dancing rhythm.
Jesus. Oh, you are my Jesus who loves me. We praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Getting ready to take up our offering, which is a worship moment. I want you to remember our care cards. Take a care card out if you're a first-time guest with us this morning. We're really glad to have you. And pray that you'll take a card and fill out the front. If you've been here before and done that, take a card, please. Put your name on the front and on the back, whatever decisions or requests you want to make known, prayers for other people. Our care team will meet Tuesday night. We need care volunteers. I think there's a sign-up sheet out on the welcome table or the welcome desk in the front. And pray that you'll take one of these cards and fill it out and come be a part of our care team on Tuesday nights. One night a month, if you will just come. Choose your night and come be a part of it. We pray and we seek God, and we don't ask you to do anything that you don't feel comfortable doing, whether it's prayer or writing a letter or a card, but be a part of that. Remember, as you leave today, as you exit on the right and the left out in the foyer, there are truelife.org cards. Invite people to church. Invite them to Kinley Missionary Baptist Church, and you just go up to people. It's so simple. Say, hey, I'd like for you to go to our church, Kinley Missionary Baptist. We're out there on 222 Highway, but if you can't come, go to that website, truelife.org. It's got answers, video answers for life's difficult questions. It's done. And most people are going to take the car. Maybe one or two will give it back to you. Hadn't had anybody be ugly to me yet doing this. And that might come. Hallelujah. You know, the Bible says when you're persecuted, Don't worry about it, because they persecuted your Savior. Amen. All right. I'm ready to give some money. Pray.
Lord God, you are our Jesus who loves us, each and every one of us. Thank you, Jesus, for the sacrifice you gave for us. Lord, we come this morning, and all we come is to seek and be more like Jesus in every way. Lord God, we have an opportunity right now to be like Jesus in our giving, Lord. You gave everything for us when we didn't deserve it. Lord, we just ask that you help us to give back to you in the same fashion that you gave to us, with a with a willing heart and just a willing mind, and that we would show you our love through our giving, Lord God. We praise and we thank you, Lord Jesus. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
I wish there was a way to convey to y'all what happens up here sometimes. It's truly amazing. I know that you all see what happens on Sunday mornings, but whenever we rehearse and we get things together, we really do our best to try and get things figured out. And sometimes it goes according to plan, sometimes it doesn't. But the best times are whenever it doesn't matter what happens, and God is lifted up and glorified. And it's a neat experience to be up here and be able to be a part of that and see it from both sides. I pray that the Lord is speaking to your heart through this song as well, as Eric sings with us at the cross, Love Ran Red.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you. Here my hope is found, here on holy ground, here I bow down, here I bow down. Here, arms open wide, here you see my surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where you're my sin washed white. I owe all to you. I owe all to you. I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus.
But I didn't teach him how to sing. Oh, man. Good job, Eric. Praise God. Amen. God is good. Okay. Praise God. How many of you ever heard of Isaac Newton? Sir Isaac Newton. He even got knighted. Great scientist. He wrote more books about God than he did about science, but he wrote a ton of books about science. They didn't have TV and all this stuff back in that day, and so they had to occupy themselves with more profitable things. And Newton had a law. In fact, he was a Christian, and so many other scientists, early scientists, were Christians. Up and way into the 19th century, even today, 21st century, there's still many scientists that are Christians. Copernicus and Kepler and Galileo, Linnaeus, and the list goes on. Faraday, just tons and tons of scientists. But Newton had a proposition, a theorem, a law, in essence, that every action has a reaction. So, you know, if I came up today and I apply pressure and I move the desk, it's on sliders, so it's really easy to do. It's not that hard. I push, there's an action, and there's a reaction. It's true of everything in life. But I want us to look this morning at the truth that God is sovereign. He's sovereignly in control of everything that goes on in the universe. Jesus himself says, when a sparrow falls from the sky, God knows about it. Well, I want you to think about that just a minute. That sparrow is, according to my interpretation of that passage, the sparrow is falling to its death. God's aware of it. God's aware of everything. God's in control of everything. He either allows it to happen or he causes it to happen. And he could stop anything from happening if he wanted to. So when you say God is sovereign, you've got to humble yourself. You've got to begin to realize I don't have all the answers. And I can't question God in the sense of God's truth and righteousness and holiness. Now I can ask God why things happen, but I don't question his righteousness and his holiness and his sovereignty. He is a sovereign God, and if you're going to worship him, if you're going to be one of his children, one of his people, you have to just realize that's who he is, and he is always right. Even when we don't think he might be right, God is right at all times. So God is always in everything, whether he allows it or whether he causes it to happen. And I want to tell you this morning that every time something good happens, God caused something to happen before it, or God allowed it to happen before. That's why Romans 8:28 says everything works together for good to those who love God and those who called according to his purpose, those who are seeking to do his will. Because you begin to see, even in adversity, even in sorrow, even in tough times, good or bad, you begin to realize if you really trust God and look to him and realize he is sovereign, that it works out for the good. You find something good that comes from it. The Bible says we love. The only reason we love because he first loved us. God said, let there be light, and there was light. Something he did, a result of something he did or actually said. So, God is totally in control of the world. Do you know what that means? Just wrap your head around that a minute. Do you know how much power Satan has? Do you know how much power Satan has? He has as much as God allows him to have. That's it. You know how much the president and the Supreme Court of the United States and the Congress and the governor, how much power they have? They have as much power as God allows them to have. You know, I think that's awesome. So we don't need to worry. If you fear God, there's no need, the Bible says, to fear anyone else. So God is always previous. God is always before all things. We're going to look at a few verses this morning from several books. We're going to begin in Colossians chapter 1, 16 through 18. God is always previous. This is very true of creation. In Colossians 1, it says, "For by him all things were created, that are in heaven and that are on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or powers or principalities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things. He is previous to all things. And in him all things consist," or all things stand, or all things are held together. I firmly believe if God, and he can't do this, it would never happen, but if God would just leave the universe would fly apart. Scientists today are baffled by the idea of dark matter and dark energy and stuff they can't explain, and they say there's something holding the universe together, and we don't know what it is. Well, I know what it is. It's God. And he's head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things they may have the preeminence. Creation is an essential truth. You need to believe that God created the heavens and the earth. It could not have just happened. I use the illustration often of you could take all the ingredients to make that chair right there and put them in a room and have windstorms and lightning and do all kinds of things and throw that chair, all the pieces of that chair up in the air down a million trillion times, and it would never come out of chair. It's designed. And you look at the world around you, there's design, there's meaning, there's purpose. And so the water cycle, anything, look at anything. The human body, there's a design, there's a purpose, there's a reason for it. And if there's a design, there has to be a designer. We say that chair. If I'd have just told you that chair just happened, it just happened. Yeah. No. There's design, there's purpose. So there was a designer. God comes before all things. He's in the preeminence. So I preached last week on revival, and I want to continue that today, and I'm going to continue that in the next few weeks because that's the only hope for our nation. We can have another election, and we can let who knows what put them in the White House, in the Congress, and everywhere else, and it might have a minor effect, but our nation is not going to realize true peace and love and prosperity and tranquility until we turn back to God. It's the only hope for this nation. It's the only hope for my children and my grandchildren. And I'm telling you, I don't care so much about me anymore, but I'm caring a whole lot about them. And we need to pray for revival. And one of the things that stands in opposition to God is the lie of macroevolution, that things can change from one kind to another kind. You know, a cow can become another kind of animal. An ape can become a man. And these types of things, there's no proof. There is no proof of this anywhere in the archaeological record, the geological record, nowhere. Has this been shown? Oh, they come out every now and then and say, oh, we found such and such. We found some bones over here. And we believe that's the transition. Go back and read it and study it. After a while, somebody comes along and says, no, that was either an ape, that was either a man, that was, you know, fish, or it was a lizard. It wasn't a transition form. Things don't change from one kind of animal to another kind of animal. God created the world out of nothing. Ex nihilo, we say in the Latin term for it. God created the world, and it says it in Genesis. In the beginning, God said, let there be, and there was. You know what? Science has finally concluded that there wasn't anything here, and something happened from nothing. The scientists, really, many scientists, now there's some scientists today that want to believe in a steady state universe. It means it just is always continued forever and ever. But that has been disproven, and they're the scientists on the fringe who say they believe in a steady state universe. There wasn't a beginning. And I think one of the main reasons they want to believe there wasn't a beginning because the Bible says, in the beginning. So there was a God, and they don't want to believe in God, so they want to believe in a steady state universe. We've talked about all this before. I'm just trying to get you to understand that science is now saying they think the world came from nothing. The whole universe came from nothing. Well, do you know of anything that comes from nothing? I don't know of anything that comes from nothing. It takes a God to make something from nothing. I mean, if something came from nothing, there couldn't have been electricity. There couldn't have been anything to make something from nothing, to explode. You couldn't have had a bang. You couldn't have had a little bang if you had nothing. It takes a God. I was looking this week at the egg. It's really fascinating to me. You know the old saying, we all try, always try to answer. I know the answer to this because I have a biblical worldview. And if you have a biblical worldview, you understand the answer to this question. Which came first, the chicken or the egg? Well, God didn't say he created an egg. He said he created chickens. He created animals. So the chicken came first. You know, it's pretty. But it depends on whether you have a biblical worldview or not. Now, I love the egg. I was reading this week. My son works for Purdue Chickens. And he and a buddy of his were talking about his buddy raises ducks and geese and guineas. And they were talking about eggs hatching. And I found this out. I looked it up online. Canary eggs are born in 14 days. An egg hatches in 14 days. A barnyard hen hatches in 21 days out of the egg. Ducks and geese hatch out of eggs every 28 days. A mallard hatches every 35 days. You catching this? And an ostrich and a parrot every 42 days. Those are all multiples of 7, which is the number of completion or perfection for God. I'm going, wow, God, you did it again. The Bible says in Romans 1 that the invisible attributes of God, we cannot see God, we can't touch him, can't smell him, he's invisible. But it says the invisible attributes of God are evident in his creation, in the world. And I look at those 7s and I think, hey, God, you're doing something here. I look at the Trinity. People say, I don't understand. How can there be 3 people and be 1 and 1 and 3? You can't have 3 people and 1 and 1 and 3, the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit, but 1, but there are 3. That can't happen. Well, I think God showed us signs of that in the universe. He made an atom. An atom has 3 parts, the nucleus, the proton, and the electron. 3 parts. They all have to be together to make an atom. You take one out, the atom ceases to exist. Takes all 3. So there's 3 different parts, but they make one thing. We live in a 3-dimensional world. We have height, we have length, and we have width or depth. You take one of those away, you need all 3 to have a 3-dimensional world. If you take any one of those, if you take width away, then that thing has no width, then it can't exist. Because it can't have height, it can't have length if it doesn't have width. So 3-dimensional universe. You need all 3, height, length, and width, but you can't have anything without all 3. It takes all 3. And I can go on with several other things. Human beings, spirit, soul, body. 3 dimensions. The 3 states of matter, liquid, solid, and gas. Tons of things. So God created. You got to believe this. You got to understand God created the heavens and the earth, because then you understand the plan or purpose for being here. That's why I think so many people commit suicide. A lot of suicide's prevalent among young people today. More people are committing suicide than ever in our history. And I believe it's because a lot of them don't have any hope. A lot of them pull out guns and go into schools and shoot people. I'm telling you, that didn't happen when I was a kid. Did not happen. I can't remember one incident in the time I was being raised when something like that happened. I believe it's because we're pulling God out. We're turning away from God. People have no hope, and so they do all kinds of crazy, distorted things. God created the world, and therefore, God has a plan. He has an eternal purpose. And his purpose right now is he created human beings. We sinned. We fell away from him. And so now he wants to redeem us or restore us or reconcile us. He wants to save us. And that's what the Bible is all about. From Genesis to Revelation, it's about God's plan to save people. He desires that all people be saved and need to come to the knowledge of the truth. We need to be redeemed, and that's why I'm preaching this series on revival. That's our only hope. When our nation turns around and comes to God, and when the people sitting in the pews and sitting in the schools and every institution that we have in our country, when they begin to come to God, it will change our country. It will change Washington. It will change Raleigh. Everything will be changed. And it's happened in our history several times in the past. We've had several great awakenings. Why do we need a revival? Because it's going to keep getting worse, folks. It's going to keep getting worse and worse. I say this a lot, and I don't mean this in hatred of anybody or anything, but a few years from now, if it keeps going the way it is, I will not let my child go in a public bathroom. I don't know what's going to be in there. And there's people that believe if we just let anybody who feels like anything they want to that day go anywhere they want to in a public bathroom, don't they see this can cause problems? Can't they understand that? But I think we're blind because we're in rebellion against God. But God is always previous in everything. God has a plan for everything. And I believe most of everything that's happening to us in our nation today, all the good and all the bad and everything mixed in, is part of God's plan. Part of God's plan to get us to draw to Him. And as we see things getting worse, nuclear proliferation and countries getting nuclear weapons that have vowed to destroy other countries, I mean, that's in their constitution. We want to destroy this country. So what do you think they're going to do with nuclear weapons? You know, it's crazy. What can save us? God. And I'm telling you, God is always previous, and He's working in our time right now, and He's working in such a way that He wants us to draw us to Him so that He can save us and so that He can reconcile and redeem us. God is always, before an awakening comes, before a revival comes, He's always working. He's preparing the way. He's drawing people to Him. He's purifying people. He's stirring things up. The heart of God is the desire that all people be saved. So I want to look this morning at the Gospel of Luke and look at the story of John the Baptist. It says, now, in the 15th year of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip tetrarch of Iturea, the region of Trachonitis, and Lysanias tetrarch of Abilene, finally found a word I could pronounce. Abilene, Texas, or Kansas, whatever. While Annas and Caiaphas were high priests, the word of God came to John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness, and he went out into all the region around the Jordan preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. So God's working. God's getting ready to cause something to happen here. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah, the prophet, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill brought low. The crooked places shall be made straight, and the rough way smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. Then he said to the multitudes that came out to be baptized by him, brood of vipers! Just see if you are awake, but isn't that a way to get a congregation together? You snakes! You slimy snakes, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore, bear fruits worthy of repentance, and do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I say to you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. Don't say I was born a Jew, and therefore, or I was born in church. That doesn't have anything to do with this, he says. You have to have a renewed heart. And even now the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree which does not bear fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. So the crowd asked him, saying, what shall we do then? See, God's working. Sometimes the preacher can sit up here and run his mouth all day long, but unless we pray over it, unless we seek God, you know, nothing can happen of eternal consequence. You know, we need to pray. We need to pray right now. Y'all need to pray for me. I need some help. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you that you're an awesome God and that you love us. And Lord, we cannot do nothing, anything, the Bible says, apart from you. But through you, we can do all things. And Lord, I'm just praying that my heart's going to be convicted truly of those words, that I can do nothing of eternal consequence, the eternal significance of value. Lord, without you, Lord, we need your blessing in everything. And Lord, I need you to speak through me this morning. I need you to cause our hearts to be circumcised so that we can hear what you want to tell us. Lord, we need revival. We need a stirring. And it begins in my heart. It begins in my soul. And then it goes out into all the world. And it needs to happen in this church. And Lord, it needs to be happening among your people, regardless of the denomination. Help us not to be envious or jealous of other churches that are growing and receiving God and the Spirit. And they're just happy about Jesus. Help us to promote whatever, wherever you're stirring. Lord, help us to fan the flames. And Lord, to pray and to seek your face. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. People said, "What shall we do?" He answered and said to them, "He who has two tunics, let him give to him who has none, and he who has food, let him do likewise." The tax collectors also came to be baptized and said to them, "Teacher, what shall we do?" And he said to them, "Collect no more than what is appointed to you. Don't steal or don't extort from people." Likewise, the soldiers asked him, saying, "All these people, the soldiers and the tax collectors, had some power in their day. And what shall we do?" the soldiers asked. So he said to them, "Do not intimidate anyone or accuse falsely, and be content with your wages." Don't use your authority to lord it over people to gain money or gain work from them. Don't intimidate people. Now as the people were in expectation and all reasoned in their hearts about John, whether he was the Christ or not, the people were realizing they were needing Christ at this time. They were needing the Messiah to come, and he'd been tarrying for a long time, and they were beginning to wonder, is John the promised Messiah? John immediately says, "Let's get one thing straight." That's what you and I need to do when people start praising us and thinking we're somebody. We're not. And we know God's working through us. We know God's doing the work. We need to defer the glory to God. We need to humble ourselves and pray and seek his face and turn from our wicked ways. John answered, saying to all, "I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I is coming, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose." I can't even tie his shoelaces. "He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." Amen. "And fire." Boy, don't know about the fire part. His winnowing fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor and gather the wheat into his barn, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." And with many other exhortations, he preached to the people. God is always previous. God is always working. God is always trying to get his plan in place. He's getting his plan in place, and we need to realize it, and we need to join him in what he's doing. I want to look this morning at least six things that God uses to prepare for revival, and we need to do what God wants to do. We need to do it God's way. "Thy will be done, thy kingdom come." Six things. These six things come from a guy named Bill Elliff, who's with the Southern Baptist Convention. I heard him speak the other week at the revival meeting I was at. And so these are his six things. He says, "Voices are sent." In Luke chapter 3, verse 2, it says, "The word of God came to John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness." In John chapter 1, 6, it says, "There was a man sent from God whose name was John." All throughout history, whether we deserve it or not, God always has a voice for his people. Many times we don't listen to the voice, but God has a voice. John was a voice crying in the wilderness. Sometimes it's hard to hear. Sometimes preachers don't listen. Sometimes leaders don't listen. Sometimes Sunday school teachers don't realize I'm the voice. God sent me. We don't think we're praise team leaders. We're the voice. We're the voice of God, and we need to take that very, very seriously. Don't get into the pulpit. Don't get into the Sunday school classroom. Don't stand up here to lead in music if you don't hear a word from God. And too often, we get in these places and we're not even praying for God to speak through us. I got plenty to say myself. You know, we need to hear a word from God. I heard one guy put it like this for preachers. You deliver the baby on Sunday and you get pregnant on Monday. You get another word from God, and you work on that word of God all week, and you pray, and you seek him, and you deliver the baby on Sunday, and you get pregnant on Monday. I like it. Pray this prayer before you teach, before you preach, before you lead anything. Lord, what do you want to say to your people? Use me as your vessel. I mean, do it in your work. Do it everywhere. And this voice is a message. It's a message of repentance. He says in Luke 3:8, bear works worthy of repentance. And this means repentance with no regrets, repentance with no looking back, oh, I wish I could still do. Turn your back on what's wrong in your life, the things that separate you from intimate fellowship with God. Turn your back on it. Get rid of it in your life. Say, I need Jesus more than I need those things. The message, the voice is a message of judgment. The axe is laid to the root of the tree, it says in our passage this morning. God loves us enough to tell us what's coming. If judgment's coming, God always warns his people. And God does bring judgment. God is just and he's holy and he's righteous and he's a wrathful God. And he's loving and he's merciful and he's gracious. And so when he comes and he brings wrath, he's chastening us. He's trying to get us to wake up and listen so we can run into his arms just like a little child runs to their parent for protection, to be loved, to be forgiven, and to wrap their arms around him. So God is bringing wrath on our nation right now. I believe 9-11 and all those things. I don't believe God necessarily did 9-11, but he allowed it to happen just like the sparrow he allows to fall from the sky. And these things are happening. Our nation, I still don't know why our nation hasn't fallen in tremendous debt. Now, we haven't gone bankrupt. We owe over $18 trillion. I still can't believe there haven't been more bombings and things happening in our society, more planes and bombs flying into buildings. I believe God still has a protection on us, over us, but I believe he's beginning to withdraw it, and we have got to listen to him. The axe is laid at the root of the tree. You know, pain can be a loving, caring thing. If you put your hand on a stove, it's a loving, caring thing for you to go, oh, that hurt. Or else you're going to burn up your whole hand. You know, burn up the house, whatever. I mean, pain, it can be a wonderful thing, a loving thing. But sometimes pain and anguish and things come gradually. And that's when it really gets us, because it gradually begins to destroy us. And I believe that's what's been happening to our nation. Seems like we're in overdrive right now. Seems like things are beginning to happen. Boom, boom, boom. I don't know. The message was a message of repentance. It was a message of judgment, but it was also a message of hope. John says, one mightier than I is coming. He is the only hope. I'm telling you, Jesus is the only hope for our nation today. And we as Christians have got to stand up and declare it. We got to shout it from the rooftops. And I don't care what people say. We need to tell them Jesus is the answer. They can call you dumb. You know, you might not have all the answers to their questions. You just keep telling them, Jesus is the answer. You need Jesus. You know, you need him to save you or you're going to hell. Well, we don't believe in hell. Well, I'm sorry. The Bible says it. And I'm telling you this because I love you. Don't say this in anger. Don't say this in animosity or being holier than thou. That's why 2 Chronicles says, humble yourselves. It's a message of hope. And that hope is always Jesus. The voice is always pointing people to Jesus. Always. You are the voice. I am the voice. And we are pointing people to Jesus. Second thing that we need in preparation for revival is a desperate. Desperation deepens, he says, and a cry erupts. It's beginning to happen to me now. I tell you, it's been going on for years. When I first came to this community, and I came as your interim pastor, I used to walk, that summer I was teaching high school, and I walked around the community, and I would pray. That's all I did. I walked through the church halls and sanctuary, and I prayed. And I prayed for God to bring revival. I don't even know if I knew what I was praying about, but I was praying. I think I was doing what God wanted me to do. And our church was already growing. It continued to grow. And we had some baptisms and some things were happening. And I believe it was prayer. And y'all, some of y'all were praying, I know. And we just need to pray. You know, and somewhere along the line, I've gotten busy with other things. I still pray. I don't pray out of desperation. I remember when I came to this church, I hadn't been preaching for about 2 years, and I was kind of praying out of desperation. God, I don't know how to lead this church. I sort of like Solomon, you know, in the Bible. I'm just a young, I don't know what to do. I need your help, you know. And I think God blessed. There's no doubt about it. This building, there's so many things that you can just see. Lives saved, people baptized and saved. And, you know, it started happening to me. But lately, my soul's on fire. I want to serve my Lord, and I want to give it all to him, and I don't care what anybody else says. I don't want to care what anybody else says. I still got some of the old flesh in me, and I let what other people say get to me. And God is beginning to work on our nation, and he's moving. He's previous in all things, and I don't want him to pass by. You know, I want God to come in all his fullness, and so I want to cry out to him. Desperation deepens, and a cry erupts. Listen to this, in 3:10 it says, so the people asked him, saying, what shall we do? The crowd came, said, what shall we do? Desperation deepens and a cry erupts. Judgment is coming. What do we need to do? That's what John's preaching. Judgment's coming. Get ready. And they're saying, what do we do? I'm telling you, we cannot change the fix we're in this nation on our own. God made this nation. Just like he caused this church to grow, and he made this nation to grow and be one of the best nations in the history of the world with freedom and democracy. And it's not been perfect. You know, it would be perfect if we would all fall on our knees and trust in Jesus. It would be perfect. But I thank God that he made the leaders and the founders of this country write a constitution that said we have that freedom. We have that freedom to worship. And so we've got the basis, we've got the foundation. It depends on you and me, whether we're going to trust God, whether we're going to fall on our knees. You know, if one person in every little burg and hamlet and village in America would start praying in desperation, it would change this nation. It would change us. And it could change us fast, quickly. Hallelujah. We've got to pray in desperation, though. You can't pray for 30 seconds and say, okay, God, revival time, we want it, come on. Now, what's for supper? What's playing at the movies? What's on TV? We have got to change. We got to seek God. We got to be desperate. I told you last week, you know, if your daughter was going for an interview for a job, you'd pray one way, but if she was captured by a terrorist organization, you'd pray a whole different way. Because when she was captured by the terrorist organization, you couldn't do anything to get her back. You can go help her get a job. That's our problem. We're not dependent on him to get these. We think we can do it ourselves. He tells the people we're in expectation. The tax collectors, the soldiers, and the crowds came. When revival comes, God's going to be stirring in the hearts of all the people, all different stratas of society, and God's going to be moving in people's lives, and people are going to be saying, what is going on? What do I need to do? I talked last week about stories of people coming into Boston Harbor during the first Great Awakening in the 1740s in our country. Sailors, rough, tough, cursing, rough sailors would be coming into the Boston Harbor, and before they even got to the harbor, the Spirit of God would fall on them, and they would get off the ships when they landed, and they'd say, what must we do to be saved? Somebody tell me how I can get out of this predicament. I believe if we were truly having revival, people would ride by that church out there and the Holy Spirit would grab them and they'd come in here and they'd say, what must I do to be saved? Because that is the only answer for you, for me, for our nation. Everybody. It's amazing the past week, the people I have talked to and Ann has talked to, and people are hungry. So many of the people we have talked to are hungry for revival, and they're at their rope's end. I talked with a pastor this week who told me he was ready to quit. Been in his church over 20 years. He says, I got all kinds of issues in my life. I'm getting older, and I don't think the church is doing anything. I'm just depressed. I've been seeing a psychiatrist or a psychologist, and, you know, I just don't know what's going on. And I started talking to him about revival, and he said, let's meet next week. He said, this is what I need to hear. People are hungry. If we would just pray and seek his face, God is going to cause revival. Another thing we need to do in preparation for revival, God does, is repentance occurs. Luke 3:8 says, bear fruits worthy of repentance, John says. In Mark 1:5, and it says, and all the people went out to him confessing their sins. A genuine confessing of repentance. I'm going to tell you, when that happens, it's going to be messy. People are going to start slobbering all over themselves. oh God, what have I done? I mean, it's going to be messy. People are going to do things. You say, we don't do that in this church. And we need order in all of it. But let me tell you, when God starts working and the Spirit of God starts laying heavy on people, people are going to cry out and they're going to turn to God in a powerful way. And it's going to get messy, you know. And we need to, Satan's going to come in. Satan's going to try to destroy it and rob it. He's going to try to create false situations, and he's going to try to mess it all up. Let me ask you this morning, are there things in your life that you know you're putting ahead of God? That's idol worship. I'm telling you, this week, Ann and I haven't played one game of solitaire in 8 days. 10 days, 12 days. I don't know. It's been a long time. You know what? I don't miss it. I used to tell myself, oh, God, I've worked for 2 hours. I need to play some. I need to relax, and I need to play some song. And I pray now. I just pray. I get renewed. I get restored. A lot better than I did when I played solitaire and lose the game and play another game so I can win, and then I play another game because I didn't. I got to play another game so I can win. You know? I haven't met, we've watched very little TV. I'm not saying TV's all wrong or playing cards is all wrong and there's a place for all of that. I'm just saying we put too many things ahead of God, and then we want to say, God, why aren't you taking care of, I go to church on Sunday. God, I give you 2 hours. What more do you want? We need to repent of that. Scripture needs to be our focus, and this is the scripture that I'm going to be praying, and I want you to pray. I told you last week about 7:14. Put it in your phone, 7:14 in the morning. Get your alarm to go off. Put it on all the phones in your alarm clocks in your house. If you want to, 7:14 at night, and this is the prayer. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, not think more than you ought to of yourself, and pray. And it doesn't pray diligently, pray all the time, pray without ceasing, it says in 1 Thessalonians 5:16 through 18. Pray without ceasing. If my people will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, if you seek him first, you know, you will find him. If you seek him early, you will find him. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything else will be added to you. We need to seek him with our hearts, with everything. Do you realize that the nation your children are going to be growing up in? We need to seek God with all our heart, desperation. And then we need to turn from our wicked ways. We need to turn from anything that is keeping us from intense, close fellowship with God. Yes, God has died for all our sins, and he's forgiven us of all our sins, but that don't mean we still don't sin, you know? And when we sin, it's just like any relationship I have with anybody in this room or with my wife. If I don't come clean, if I don't say, confess means to say the same thing as. If I don't agree with God that I'm off target, then how am I going to get back on target? An alcoholic has to admit he's an alcoholic before he can get rid of alcoholism. You understand? We've got to confess our sins. We've got to turn to God, and we've got to realize, I know you're sitting there thinking, well, I'm not wicked. You know, if you compare yourself to a pure, holy God who has no error, no mixture of sin, or no wrong thinking, and is, buddy, you're pretty wicked. And that's where, if you want revival, you need to realize that. I fall way short of the glory of God. Thank you, Jesus, you died on the cross for my sins. Thank you, I can run to you any moment, any day, at night, any time, and you will hear me. You will listen. You will cleanse me. You will restore the relationship. You will bless me. Thank you, Jesus. But our prayer has to be desperate. God's working. He's sending voices, and we need to be desperate in our praying. Number four, unity builds. When God makes revival come about, and before it happens, he prepares people with building unity. The multitudes, it says in 3:7, came out, and all the land of Judea and those from Jerusalem went out to him, and all were baptized in the River Jordan. Oh God, what if all of Kinley Missionary Baptist Church came together? What if all the Kinley Missionary Baptist Church came together, and prayed and saw Jesus and repented, what would happen if this whole church would come to God and get on fire for him? What would happen? We'd tear this town apart with love, with grace, with mercy. People would be knocking on the door. What's going on? What must I do to be saved? But friends, it's going to take all of us. And it's going to take us all coming together. And it's not going to take us. It needs to go down to all the other churches. It needs to spread throughout this town and throughout this county and throughout this nation. What if all the people in Johnston County were coming out and wanting to be saved and wanting to repent? Would it change our nation? Yes. It'd change the next county and the next county in the state. And the news reporters would be coming saying, what is happening? I'm telling you. Y'all here? Man. We got to break down the walls and the barriers. We can't do it. Only God can. Oh, man. There's going to be opposition to this, too. There's going to be opposition right here within this church. There'll be opposition everywhere else if the revival really starts going. I didn't come here for that. There might be opposition in your marriages. I don't know. But you just put God first. He'll work it all together for good. Fifth thing is spiritual activity increases. All the land of Judea from Jerusalem went out to him, and all were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Things are going to be happening. As I said, people are going to say, what's going on? I talked to you last week about that revival that's going on in northern Indiana. I told you about them shutting down schools and giving students excused absences to go out all day and pray and witness in their community. Did you know that it's the RV capital of the world, I'm told? They make those big recreational vehicles. And factories closed at lunchtime and had revivalists come in and speak to their workers. In fact, some factories closed all day. They were talking about money being made here. Closed all day long. And one of the factories where one of the guys was speaking, 100 people got up and walked out when he started speaking. Left the premises. But many people received God. I'm telling you, that's a revival when the factories start closing down. So that they can, their employees can hear the word of God. And don't care what the ACLU or anybody else has to say. And we're going to do what God tells us to do. Thank you, Jesus. 300, I told you this last week, 350 Southern Baptist preachers came together a few weeks ago just to pray. Not to pontificate, not to tell you how many they run in this week, not to tell you how many they baptized, but to pray and to realize we cannot do it apart from God. Ronnie Floyd, who's the president of the Southern Baptist Convention, now is going to go for a second term this time. They're having the convention in Columbus, Ohio. He's gotten together 11 pastors, and on Tuesday evening, he's giving a national call for prayer to all Southern Baptists for the next great awakening to reach the world for Christ. Buddy, when the Baptists start realizing we can't do it, they're not getting together and say, man, we got to get another program. Man, they're not getting together and say, oh, we got to build up our statistics. You know, we got to get more people baptized. They're not getting together. They're getting together and say, we need to seek God and what God wants and not the way we think that we can work it out. I mean, that's been our problem. Baptists have been not declining. We've been holding our own for several years now, a couple of decades. But, man, if we didn't prop everything up, we would be declining. But they're finally getting the idea. We need to pray. We need to follow 2 Chronicles 7:14. And then last but not least, Christ is exalted when God prepares for revival. John says, one mightier than I is coming, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. He says, I must decrease so that he can increase. John says, it's not about me. I can't do it. You know, I think that's what kills so many pastors, so defeats so many pastors, is they start thinking they got to do it. And they try and they try, some of them, and they preach the word and they just don't see anything happen. But it's because we're trying to do it instead of letting God do it. Instead of praying and falling on your face and weeping for the people in the congregation, Sunday school teachers, I'm talking to you too. I'm talking to praise team people. I'm talking to choir. I'm talking to you in your family. I'm talking to you in your job. We need to be the voice. We need to exalt Christ. It's not about me. Isaiah sees God and he falls on his knees and he says, I'm undone. I'm a man of unclean lips. I can't do anything. He exalts Christ. We can't dig ourselves out of the mess we're in. You know, are you experiencing some revival now? God wants to revive us. I'm telling you, I want it more than I've ever wanted anything. And I want to pray for it, and I don't want to give up, and I don't want to quit, and I want to cop out, and I don't want Satan to come in and steal it. And I know all these things are going to begin to be temptations, and they're going to be attacks on me, but I want to stay true to God, and I want to pray for revival. It's the only hope for our nation. What's our preparatory work first? Don't puff up. Don't swell up. Don't think you're more than you are. You're nobody. You're bought with a price. You're not your own, the Bible says. You're a slave to Jesus Christ. Present your bodies a living sacrifice. Don't puff up. John says, he must increase, but I must decrease. He who comes from above is above all, and that includes me. You don't you think the devil was whispering to John, hey, you're getting a crowd here, buddy. You baptized more than anybody in the whole country that baptized this year. Woo, you got something going here. John resisted that temptation. John said, it's not about me. Yeah, God's blessing, but it's not about me. Pride will quickly quench a fire. Let me tell you, if something started happening in this church and we started having more people and more people baptized and we had to break out the back wall and we got enough money to go build something else and whatever, got three or four more vans, put Kinley Missionary Baptist Church out across the side of them, you know, and people come up to us and say, what's happening? Oh, yeah, man, we doing it. We got it on in our church. It's gone. It's dead. It's over. Don't puff up, don't give up. With many or other exhortations, he preached to the people. Man, old John preached till he got his head cut off. You ready to preach that long? You ready to proclaim? I'm not talking about preaching from the pulpit necessarily. We all preach, we all proclaim. Stay focused. Will it be worth it? You think about it. Yes, it will. If this nation were to turn back to God, we'd put prayer back in schools. We'd put Bible reading back in schools. I love it when these little children come home from our daycare. You know, I told you the story a while back of the little girl who went home and said, Mama, we learned about fruit today. She said, yeah, did you learn about apples and oranges? She says, no, love and joy and peace and patience and goodness and kindness. I go, whoa! You know, you tell that to me, and at 65 years, it's gone the next day. You tell that to a 4 or 5-year-old child, it stays there forever. You know, old Ann was and I were in the car yesterday, and one of us said, I won't tell who, said, well, that's just stupid. And my little 3-year-old grandson says, that's not a nice word to say. Oh, me. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. He's good. And the last thing, always look up. Came to pass in those days that Jesus came. John had been waiting a long time for Jesus to come, and all of a sudden, John looked up. You know what he saw when he looked up? Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Thank you, Jesus. You have come. Here's the key. Here's the padlock. You take it. Thank you, Jesus. You know, look up. When things get worse and things get desperate, and look up. People come against you and attack you for witnessing for the Lord Jesus Christ. Look up. When Jesus comes, it's all going to change. And the King is coming. And I'm talking about coming in revival right now. I'm not quite ready. I have never said this before. I've told you before, I'm ready for Jesus to come back. I'm not quite ready for Jesus to come back and split the sky. I want him to come back in revival. And I want some more souls to be saved. And I want you, and I want myself to be a part of all that. Let me tell you, revival is summed up in one word, Jesus. Man, you can't get enough of him. You can't talk about him enough. You can't love him enough. Revival comes when Jesus comes into our heart. Fully comes in. Fully comes in until we say, God, you're in control. You do whatever you want in my life. When we walk in humility and we walk in hunger for the things of God. Revival is going to happen when Jesus comes into my heart, when it comes into this church's heart, when it comes into our county's heart, and our state's heart, and in our nation's heart, and it can happen. Let's pray. Father, I pray now, Lord, for your people. Lord, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to say. I can't do it. You got to do it, God. Almighty hallelujah. I cannot do it, Father. I fall so short. I have no power. I have no wisdom, Lord, apart from you. None of us do. I pray, Lord, you're going to bring revival. We're going to start getting serious about praying and getting rid of the idols in our lives and the things that separate us from intimate fellowship with you. Lord, we're going to start realizing we are in a problem, and it's not going to change. I'm not just spouting words this morning, Lord. It's not going to change until we turn to you and quit doing things the way we want to do them and do them the way thy will be done. Lord, when you prayed the high priestly prayer in John 17, you didn't pray for anybody to get new houses or cars or lands. You prayed for them, your disciples, you prayed to glorify your name and your disciples, and you prayed for them to know you and know you intimately in the power of your resurrection. You prayed, Father, that they would receive eternal life and all the blessings that you have for them. You prayed that you would guard them and keep them and deliver them from Satan and lead them not into temptation and fill them with your joy, not with things, not with material prosperity, not with more stuff. Lord, you prayed that they would be sanctified, set apart by your word, that they would hide your word in their hearts, and Lord, that would be one with the Father and Son and the Spirit, and you said, I want you to send them out, Father, into the world that they can make disciples, and Lord, I want your love to be in them. Never once, Lord, did you try to say that pray for your disciples that you wanted them to have things, and you wanted them to live in leisure and comfort. You said you want them to grow up and mature, and God, we got to get there. Our nation depends on it, and revival is going to begin with me. Lord, this morning I just ask forgiveness of my sins. Thank you, Lord, that you have cleansed me and saved me from all sin. And Lord, I just, if there's anything in my life, Lord, anything that separates me, show it to me, Lord. I want to get rid of it. I want to get rid of it. And I want our church to grow and mature, and I want to see more souls saved, more of us grow more in love with you. Lord, I want to see our nation come back and have an influence on this world, be a light again, city set on the hill. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. We're going to stand up and sing our invitation hymn, Draw Me Close. As we sing, I just pray that you'll ask the Holy Spirit to draw you close to him. If you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, all you got to do, say right now, is I believe, I trust you. I want Jesus. He died on the cross for my sins. That's all you do. Come down and tell me. Tell someone near you that it's time. It's time. It's time. Today is the day of salvation. Don't put it off another day. Hallelujah. Draw me close.
Let me go.
Take your place to fill the warmth of your